I didn't have many options, cause so. Luck, you know, luck. Luck's got a lot to do with a lot of things in life. Growing up in Philly, we didn't have accountants, doctors, lawyers, football players to idolize. You had to idolize guys that had respect, and they were the wise guys. I said to myself, dear Lord, if you give me an opportunity to grow this brand and help people, I'll put you first. So I did it. Honestly, it's hard for me to talk about God without crying. And I know that's, it's just hard. It's hard to talk about that. It's hard to talk about my kids struggling and my mother. Those three things. But there are so many people hurting. You just want to help them. And I said, you give me that, I'll give you all the glory and all the praise. You're seeing Christ love now. That's love, real love. Without real love, you have nothing. Everything else is fake. Words cannot ever express what God really is. But if He's not the center of your life, whatever you get will be taken away from you. So if I lose everything, I'll never lose Him. I'll always be rich.
Our lives are often filled with worry and chaos as the media propagates one negative story after another, bringing divide and tension within topics such as politics, religion, and race relations. These stories fuel hatred and confusion while people continue to live in fear. Yet through all this negative energy, many are delivering messages of wisdom and hope, encouraging positive change, and that's something I'm aiming to do. My name is Roger Brooks, and I'm the founder and host of American Real. I'm hopeful for our future, but we must be the change and not be a spectator in life, looking from the outside in. For as long as I could remember, I've been fascinated by people's stories. Stories speak to us, and since the beginning of time, the human race has prospered by passing down wisdom told through the essence of story. It's a way for people to aspire to become the hero they know they could be, seeing their higher self through the wisdom of others. What started out as a hobby has quickly turned into my life mission, and as I deliver a new guest each Sunday, I'll aim to prompt the questions you may be thinking, and through the power of listening, I'll allow the guest to speak and articulate their points of view in order to give you the headspace you need to realize your own hero's journey. We are one race. We are one people. Spread the word about American Real, and together let's make great stories go viral to inspire, enlighten, and empower those we love and the masses we hope to reach. On this week's episode, we take the American Real set on the road for the very first time, doubling down at the Harrah's Resort and Casino in Atlantic City. There, I meet with the undisputed heavyweight champ of Italian cooking, Steve Martorano, where we sit down inside his exquisite restaurant for a 2-hour-long conversation. When it seemed like the only future for a kid from the streets of South Philly was to drive a truck or join the mob, it was his passion for food and music that inspired him to reach for more. In his tough, yet fun-loving style, Steve discusses his struggles and vices, passion and purpose, after being saved by his love for food, his wife, his family, and his faith. For the first time ever, we get the inside track of how a trip to Mulberry Street in New York City's Little Italy provided the spark to what is now a growing chain of flourishing restaurants. In an uncut, unrehearsed, and unedited conversation, Steve provides inspiration and hope, told in his own words, as his selfless generosity and zest for life are a true example to never give up. So sit back, relax, grab a homemade meatball sandwich or Philly cheesesteak as I welcome Steve, yo cuz, Martorano.
This is American Real. I am Roger Brooks. My guest today is Steve Martorano, also known as the godfather of Italian-American cooking. You have raised the bar for the restaurant industry, taking the craft of cooking to new heights through persistence, hard work, and fulfilling your life dream. A self-taught cook, you have created a venue which offers a unique atmosphere, combining exceptional food with extraordinary music and even movies. Originally from South Philly, you have never forgotten your home and your roots. Your menus are highly influenced by the foods of your upbringing, especially dishes introduced to your family by your grandmother. You are the owner of several restaurants with locations in Las Vegas, Florida, and we're broadcasting today here in Harrah's Casino in Atlantic City. In addition, you're an author of 2 cookbooks, It Ain't Sauce, It's Gravy, and Yo Cuz, My Life, My Food, My Way. You recently appeared on The Steve Harvey Show, as well as many others, including Jimmy Kimmel, The View, and even had your own show, Yo Cuz, the Italian-American Cook, back in 2011. It's no secret that you're a man of faith, and Steve Martorano, I am honored to be with you today. Welcome to the show.
Well, it's my pleasure, and thank you for having me, Cuz. Thank you.
This is going to be a great conversation. I have so much to talk to you about because I'm passionate about your story. I've had the chance to go to your restaurant down in Florida a couple of times with friends of mine. And one thing I noticed, Steve, is that you really care. You came over, you gave us a free appetizer. As a matter of fact, I think you gave us 2. You wanted to make sure we were having a good experience, that we were comfortable, that we were happy.
Absolutely.
Do I have that right?
Absolutely. You're coming into my home, right? So you're in my house the way my mother, if you came into my home when I was growing up, the first thing my mother would say is, you want to eat? You're hungry? So that's just instilled into me, and that's how I instill it in my home. So it's like you come into my restaurant, you're in my house.
I love that. And you could feel it. You could feel the energy you're at the restaurants. And this is my first time in the Atlantic City one. It's beautiful. I can't wait to come back with my family. But let's go back to where you just were, is when you grew up. One of the things my wife and I joke about a lot is we both grew up Italian, but she grew up really Italian. My parents were second generation, so her parents were first generation. So we kind of joke around that our cupboards were different. The things in my cupboards were different than the things in her cupboards. We had peanut butter and jelly and mayonnaise and mustard. Right. She didn't have any of that.
Right.
She had olive oil. You know, they had mortadella.
Yes.
So what were your cupboards like growing up?
A little bit of both. I lived, we grew up in South Philly. My father and my mother had my mother's mother living with us. That was her mother, my grandmother, which I call Nanny. I never called her grandma. You know why Nanny? She was a hip chick, my grandmother. She worked, you know, she played bingo. She was a number writer. You know, back in those days when you play numbers, you know, you could have put a quarter down, maybe won $100, but people would call her or knock on the door and they would say, give me 302, give me 507. And she was a hip chick. My father's mother, my grandmother, was the opposite.
Okay.
In her home, it was very, okay, when you watch the scene in The Godfather when it's dark and there's a little bit of opera playing, that was like growing up in my grandmother's house. Not to jump ahead, but when The Godfather movie had came out, my neighborhood was where my mother and father and my nanny lived, was a mix, Italian, Irish, Jewish in that neighborhood. In my grandmother's neighborhood, which was like 6th and Fitzwater, there were solid Italians. So when I saw that movie, I just said, this is my grandmother's neighborhood, right? These are where the real guys are. And it was like, all of a sudden I stopped in my neighborhood and I started to hang in my other grandmother's neighborhood. Because that movie enlightened me in being an Italian, being an Italian American, you know? So that would have two different. So in my house, we had peanut butter, right? We had mayo. In my father's house, we had greens and beans, right, and pig's feet and pig skin and olive oil. Oh, my grandfather got up every morning and went to 9th Street and picked what he wanted. In my other house, my mother would go shop at the corner store or never went to 9th Street. That was the Italian market. So that was a big difference. But as a child, I understood that. And when I watched that movie, see, everybody thinks you talk about The Godfather, it's like, you know, just murder and gang. There's so much more to that. To me, it was more about family and about respect and honor. So that's why I wanted to be on that side of that family. Not that I didn't love my grandmother's family, but to be part of that, it was embracive to me, you know?
Sure.
But yeah, there were two different kind of foods.
So you experienced that as
well.
Yes,
absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So I understand you went back home this week.
I try to go back home every time I come. I say to Marsha Yomar, I said, I want to go back. We go back, I know everything. You know everything, but it keeps me humble. Keeps me remembering what it was growing up here. Was I poor? No, I wasn't poor. But there were times where there was no lunch meat in the house, and I had to make a sandwich with, again, talking about the difference between two families, sliced bread.
Sure.
My grandmother on my father's side never had sliced bread. Sliced bread, mayonnaise, and lettuce, that was a sandwich.
Right.
If you had no meat or no cold cuts. That's why I went to that side of the tracks.
Right, right,
you know,
right.
When I was growing up in school, everybody had corners, right? You hung on this corner, you hung on that corner. And the guys I went to school with hung on our neighborhood's corner. But I was the one that needed to be different. See, I was an only child. I learned to play by myself. And I was always, one thing, I don't know if it's a downfall, I was always a giver. Like, if I got a toy, I remember my mother would say, where's your toy? And I would say, Mikey's got it. What do you mean Mikey's got it? Well, he didn't have nothing, so I told him to play with it. She used to say, yeah, but I just bought it. Well, I'll go get it. It's my own. I'll get it tomorrow. He's playing with it. So that giving part was instilled in me. Like I said, I don't know if that's a downfall, because I still do it today. And some people will say, you know, people can take kindness for weakness. You know, you can push me to a certain point, then I'll stop if I know I'm getting. But always believe that a giver will never be poor. And saying again, like I wasn't poor, but my father worked 9 to 5. My grandmother had to take numbers for some money. My mother was a homemaker and she stood home. And this is a true story. My father worked for his family. And my father's been dead 35 years. You know what his paycheck was? $166. Yet he put me through Catholic school.
Wow.
Well, he was also a loan shark. So he was a saver, my father. So if he had a dollar, he'd save it till he got up to maybe 100. The guy wanted to borrow 100, he lent it to him. He got 110 back. You know, mm-hmm. So I'm saying he was a saver. So we weren't poor because everybody was basically the same. You don't know that you're poor unless you're around somebody that's rich. So if you're around people that are just like you, you don't know the difference, you know? I knew the difference on my other side of the family because they had their own business. My father worked for them. So they had the garage. I had an alley. They had a big pool in their backyard. I had the fire plug. You know, that's where you got wet. And I was okay. That was one thing I noticed. There was never jealousy. Like, I wasn't never jealous. You never went and go, why they got? It's just that you went and your cousins had it, and I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. I tell people all the time, if I got a nice car and you're my friend, you wanna borrow it? Borrow it. I like your watch. Yeah, you wanna borrow it? Borrow it. You should never be jealous of somebody because it's gonna come back and bite you. But to me, we were all the same, but I knew that we were different when you went to somebody's house, sure. But it never was, how come? It was different, that's all.
Where does that trait come from, Steve, your generosity?
I don't know.
Your mom?
Yeah. Yeah, my mom always gave of her, always put me first. And they always said that. My father used to say, I always walk behind, your son always walks first. That's the truth. Yeah. She always put me first, always had me. So you go to anybody in South Philly, right, who knew me growing up, and they used the word baby Steven. I had the word baby Steven until I was probably 45 years old. My mother used to put a bottle of baby magic all over my body that when people would pick me up, they would pick me up, not just to pick me up, they wanted to smell me. And I always smelled. If I went outside to play and I had white shoes on and they were scuffed, boom, she'd take them off, she'd clean it. If I came in sweating, boom, she'd wash me down. That's my mother. And that's why I take 7 showers a day.
Right. And a lot of pride, right?
A lot of pride. Oh, 100%. Because everything. And pride to where, even if we didn't have it, you didn't know it.
Right.
My mother would.
The way the yard is kept, the way the house is kept.
Yeah, right. Never. And we had my house, I had a couch, but the springs were falling off the ground. And my mother, wasn't ashamed of it. It still works. We still can sit there. It's fine. When we save up, we'll buy a new one.
Yeah. So what do you miss most about your mom?
She always told me the truth. She said to me, my son will never be wrong in my eyes. But if he was wrong, and I knew it, I would never say it in front of everybody. I would tell him by himself. I miss that. Encouragement, like I would say, oh, Mom, they told her before she died, like I was on that Steve Harvey show, and my mother lived with me all her life. When my first marriage, my father died 2 weeks before I got married. So that dark cloud was over my head. And we still had to have the wedding. And I remember my father only had $4,000 in insurance. So that was rough. So my mother kept everything together, like my grandmother. My grandmother, not my nanny, my grandmother Mary, they called her Fat Mary because she was big. She had to sit on 2 beach chairs. She was, wow. And she cursed. Every 4 words was F. Every 4 words was, get my fucking cigarettes. Where's my fucking chair? Send Steven to the fucking store. Every word was fuck. And that's when I was a kid growing up, not to get off the story, like my Uncle Anthony would take me and first things that I would learn was fuck. Now, I go home and I would say, what the fuck? Who taught you that? My mother said, your brother's teaching my son. I'm not sending him over there no more. But that's, you know, okay. And my mother was very strict on trying to keep me good. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that was sheltered. You want to say it was sheltered? Was I sheltered to a point where, I don't know. I really didn't know too much was going on. Say, because my mother always loved me, showed me love, you know. Me and my father were, back then, I don't think the men showed love, right? You know, you never really heard that. You never really got a kiss like that, you know. But my mother was always kissing me and making sure I was doing good in school. She was a leader. And back to what I was saying about my grandmother, she was a leader. And when my grandmother died, Mary, everything really fell apart. Like the family, everything was like this. Then everything just went like that. I didn't have that on my mother's side. You know, they were cousins and I loved them all. But my grandmother kept that side of the Martorano family. The other side was Durrani, and this side was Martorano. She kept it. When she died, everything just went away. My cousin Carol, which is my grandmother's sister's daughter, she's trying to keep it together. But things don't last. Nothing lasts forever, I guess. You know.
Now, are both sides Italian?
Both sides. My grandfather, George, came from Palermo. As far as I'm concerned, I'm all Sicilian.
Okay.
And we have hard heads. I know I have that trait. Marsha will, my wife will tell you that I have a hard head. But I didn't grow up with Sicilian cooking. Now, I don't know if it's because you couldn't find the things that my grandfather would use sardines, and we would make a dish called pasta cansalde, which had fennel and sardines and raisins and pine nuts. But we also had like an Italian gravy, which is not tomato sauce, it's gravy. And it's had like pig's feet, pig skin, and spare ribs and meatballs. And that was more Navidan to me, you know, from Naples. But there's always was a little bit of Sicilian touch in something. Like she made greens, she put aligi in it, like anchovies. She always did that. And I love that style of cooking. So I'm a Sicilian as far as I'm concerned.
And is that where most of the influence came from? When you started to really think about food as a love of yours?
I didn't have many options because luck, you know, luck's got a lot to do with a lot of things in life. Dreams, goals, everybody I seems today with the internet is like, never give up, which I say never give up, excuse me. Follow your dreams, follow your goals. I had none of that. I just had to pay bills. Growing up in Philly, we didn't have accountants, doctors, lawyers, football players to idolize. You had to idolize guys that had respect, and they were the wise guys. And my family, when I say the Martorana side, you know, they were connected. And when you get to a certain age, you start to see the newspaper in the neighborhood. You start to see your name, Martorano, and then the people around you start acting a little different. And it's like, really? Yeah, that's my uncle. It's my Uncle Raymond. No, that's Long John. Yeah, but it's right. I don't call him Long John. I call him Raymond.
And yeah. Can you talk about that, Steve?
Like, yeah,
What was happening back in those days?
They were the best days. They were the best times in my life because Angelo Bruno, who I met quite a few times, to me was probably one of the greatest leaders of a family, the greatest father of a family. I was born 1957, didn't know much in the 60s, but in the 70s, I knew. And I was around, of course, every time I would go to my uncle's house, you know, he would be there. I never was able to talk to him. He had asked me a couple times a couple things, which I was honored of. But he kept a reign of nonviolence in Philly. Listen, I didn't grow up with murders. I didn't grow up reading about this one got whacked, this one got killed. What I grew up on is when my uncle walked into a room, boom. Got kissed, handshaken.
Respect.
Respect. A couple guys went bad later, but like guys like Sonny Riccobeni and Harry Riccobeni, the Riccobeni brothers, to me, I love them. You know, I love them. When I was growing up, you know, if I saw Sonny or I saw Harry, you know, we hugged, we kissed, and, you know, there was respect there. But they're kids, you know, they're kids. A lot of bad things happen, so a lot of bad things happen to my friends. I'm not condoning any of that. I'm just saying, people like Salvi Testa, who was after Angelo had gotten killed, and that's just a long story. How he gotten killed? It's all about greed.
Right in front of his house, right?
It's all about greed. You know, it's all about greed. And then the next guy stepped along. Well, my uncle, I really thought had an opportunity to be that guy. My uncle was a businessman and he made a lot of money, but Phil Testa, which was you know, second in command and. He got to be the job, and his son was a dear friend of mine, Salvi Testa. I love Salvi, you know. I love Salvi to death. We all went to school together. They were like a year older than me. Like Frankie Narducci, they were like a year older than me. and I was a year younger, but we all still were connected. We saw each other, we knew each other. And it was like, just, you know, like my friend Nicky Whip, you know, he was another young kid from just us guys. What were we going to do with our lives? Be a truck driver? What are we? We're not going to be a doctor. We're not going to be a lawyer. So how do we get the schedule in our pockets? How do we get the money? We got to work our way into something. Again, my mentality was not murderous. And you just thought you were going to be part of something that you could be proud of. I know stories where Angelo Bruno, people didn't have to pay money to pay their electric. It wasn't here and give me back more. Take care of it. Somebody needed something. I know Ange, Mr. Bruno, did it. He got it. He did it for them. And I know my uncle did that a lot of times. Somebody needed something, and he helped them. So that's the people we idolized, and to a sense to be, maybe one day we could be part of that inner circle. Not the outer bands, but the inner circle, you know? But as anything happens with greed and jealousy, and people start getting killed, and people start going to jail, like, I had a cousin, Georgie, that never been pinched in his life, but he got pinched on a drug charge, a marijuana charge. And it's a true story. And when I say true story, you're going to shake your head and say, how could this be? Because when I tell you what happened, the next question's got to be, well, nobody did this. Why did it take 32 years? You know when you take a plea? Mm-hmm. You know what that means?
Sure.
Okay. You take a plea, you know you're guilty.
You're facing a lesser charge.
150,000 years. You're going to get a lesser charge. Mm-hmm. You're going to get a fine. And you're going to do your bid and come home. Whatever it is, but you're coming home. Well, he had his attorney was Bobby Simone. And Bobby Simone was connected with, you know, Nicky Scarfo. That was, well, it was connected to everybody as a lawyer. And he was Georgie's lawyer. And he tells Georgie, take the plea. There was more defendants on this. Georgie made them all walk. He took it all. I'm guilty. Come on, give me what's mine. Let me get out of here. Let me get on with my life. But he got life without parole for a marijuana charge. Life without parole. Listen, I am not smart. I'm sorry. I got some street smarts, but I'm not book smart. But somebody's got to tell me something's wrong. And then after years of fighting, and Georgie did a lot of this fighting himself, he finally got somebody to see this was injustice for a marijuana charge that is legal today, that people are walking around with a card to buy marijuana. And he did 32 years of his life for a plea bargain that should have never happened.
You would think he would have a lawsuit.
Think about it.
Yeah.
Then my Uncle Raymond, which was his father, was doing time. So Georgie goes away, his father's away. So it's like, what am I going to do now, right? All my friends are getting killed. I said,
how old were you at this point?
18, 19, okay. Right? It's like, I didn't have no skills. I liked music, right? Music, well, my uncles owned a company that was called John's Vending Corporation in Philadelphia. Vending machines, pinball machines, pool tables. And my father would go around, collect the money. It was always change in my house. Yeah. I needed to go to the store, I'd grab 50 cents, right? I'd grab 75 cents. There was always change. And so the vending business was part of our lifestyle. And Angelo Bruno was considered to be the head salesman for the company, you know? So I didn't know what to do. I mean, was I going to be part of the vending business? Was I going to collect change? Was I going to be a gopher and go do this? I was never that person. So I liked music, because being in the vending business, my father would always take home 45s, right? So you had the 45s, and probably people out there don't even know what a 45 is. Put a 45 in, you listen to the music, and I loved R&B soul music. I never really liked rock and roll. I loved R&B. And I always I can remember in my basement, again, I'm an only child. I played the music cause, and I would dance, and I would step. and I was singing the song, and I would pretend there was an audience out there. So like in my mind, it was like, I guess I always wanted to be some kind of entertainer, right? I couldn't sing, I couldn't dance, but in that moment, when I was alone, I was that guy on stage. But then the era came around of R&B, then disco came around. And I remember my first song, I'm in a Chinese restaurant, and I get into a car with a friend of mine. There was a station called Oldies 98 FM. And that's what we would listen to. He says, did you hear the new station? What new station? I said, 98's playing disco. What's disco? And he put it on, and a song was on, and it was by Double Exposure called 10%. And I said, wow, what is this? Because there's a lot more other songs. How do I get it? What do? Just listen to the station. So I would listen to it, then I would go by the 45. Then I heard about DJs spinning in like clubs. And I had a friend of mine named Bob Pantano, who's pretty famous in Philly now, and he's on the radio till today. He's been doing it all his life. And I wound up being a bouncer down the shore, and I was working at the courtroom. And I ran that door pretty good. And right up the street was the mansion in Wildwood, and Bob Pantano was the DJ. And we were friends. And at the end of the summer, I needed a job, right? So I walked down, I said, Bob, you know, it's the end of the summer, what's going on? He goes, you ever think about being a DJ? And I said, yeah, but I don't know, cuz. I don't know what to do. And he said, you just gotta get some equipment. How much you think I need? I said, like, $3,500. Yeah, I said, yeah, get the turntables. You work with me, I get your parties, and I'll teach you how to spin. Okay, I go home and I say to my mother, Ma, I need $3,500. Yeah, where do you want me to get it? I said, well, I don't know, go ask Daddy. You go ask him. I don't want to go ask him, you go ask him. You don't want to talk to me, you talk to him. So she says, Joe, now my father used to love to sleep on the floor, just love sleeping on the floor. She calls him while he's sleeping, now he wakes up. Right now I know I hear, so your son wants to be a DJ. And he goes, yeah, what else does he want to be? He wanted to be a guitarist. He wanted to be this, he wanted to be that. What's he want? Money? I said, yeah, he needs $3,500. Where am I gonna get $3,500? He said, well, he needs it for the equipment. He can't be, I don't know where I'm gonna get it at. What do you want me to do, go on the street and borrow it?
That was a lot of money back then.
A lot of money. And he was a loan shark too, you know, he had some money out there. Not a lot, cuz, you know, not a lot. Like I said, he was a saver. He walks away. And about a half hour later, he walks into the room and he puts $3,500 down. I said, thanks, Pop. And he said, just do something with it. Wow. So I bought the equipment, and I wind up doing parties, carrying my equipment in my car, carrying cases of records. These DJs today, they walk out, right. And my son's a DJ, they walk out with a computer.
Yeah,
so much different. A fucking computer. Yeah. It's like, are you nuts? I used to have rain, snow, carrying things of records, and my turntables and hooking it up. But I loved it. And I just started. There's one thing, this is true. No one in my life ever took the time to teach me anything. Anything. Learn how to drive. I basically taught myself. I would take the car in the driveway, in my uncle's driveway, and try to drive up and down. Bob Pantano, who I loved to death, you know, but he was busy. Teach me. Other DJs, you watch what they're doing. Nobody wanted to give up their secret. So I did the best. I'm pretty strong with this part. When I say I did the best I can, I get mad at myself, because if I can do the best I can, I tell this to all my workers. Anybody says to me, I'm doing the best I can, you can never be better. So you're never going to be better. So this is all you can do. You might as well move on. And I said to myself, this is the best I can do. And I said, this can't be the best I can do. Figure it out. So what happened? I might not have been the best DJ mixer, because we would go to clubs and listen to guys for hours, and the records sounded the same. Two hours, same yeah. song, but different songs, right? I didn't have that talent. Nobody told me. But you know what I did have? I knew how to make a crowd get excited, have fun, sing that no other DJ was doing. So that became, you know, I'm proud of that. But again, like cooking, nobody taught me anything. So your question to me was, what can you do? So that was music. So I was winding up getting a job here and there. And I had a gig in Cherry Hill, and there was a circle in Cherry Hill. I forget what was a diner. It was think about this, cuz, a diner. The biggest snowstorm in Philadelphia history. Friday night, I'm booked. They were paying me $50 back then, cuz. These DJs get $60,000. $50. I gotta load my car up. I gotta drive there, unload my car, set it up. The biggest snowstorm, nobody on the road, the bartender, and a waitress. I set up on the stage, and I'm this kind of guy. I don't care if there's one person or 1,000. I'm gonna give the same show. I'm gonna try to give the same show. Do you feed off the energy of the people? Yeah, but you got a job to do, you did it. The ironic thing in my life was, they closed at 10, we were supposed to be till 1. And a guy I was with, Fat Frankie, said, you know, there's a club opened up around the corner. I said, yeah, it's a snowstorm. There's nobody in here. Well, we're in a diner, Steve. This is a nightclub. I said, Frank, it's a snowstorm. Let's go drive by. We go around the circle. There's 25,000 cars. We wait. We go in. Frankie says to me, I think the Gambino's on this. I said, oh, really? Yeah. We parked the car. Everybody's dressed in suits, ties, girls to the T. We walk in. I never saw anything like it in my life. Blue and white, sound system kicking, lights going. The biggest snowstorm in Philly, jam-packed. I'm walking down, looking around, and up, the DJ booth was up a little high. And the kid from my neighborhood's playing. And this kid was a DJ before me. I see him, he waves, he says, come on in. Hey, Joey, how you doing? He says, good, good, good. All of a sudden, on the door, you hear boom, 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 boom. I see Joey goes, I got to get that. Opens the door, and this guy walks in his suit, and in broken English, and says, you got to talk, you got to talk. Calypso, 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 buffet, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you got to talk. And Joey goes, Joe, I don't talk, I just spin. You, to me, you talk, yeah, what do you want? Say this. So I got on the microphone real loud. Oh, every Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And he shook his head like, yeah, he leaves. But as he leaves, he's talking to an older couple right below the DJ booth. And they're talking and they're looking. They're talking and they're looking. He walks away, comes back inside. You a DJ? I said, yeah. And I never spun in a club in my life, cuz. Yeah. They're talking about probably 2,000 people in this club. You see, you DJ? Yeah. You want to work in here? Yeah. Yo, Joe, you all right with that? Yeah, yeah. You work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Now, he don't know me. I don't know him, right? He says, give him my phone number to the waitress, and we call you. I go home, and I say to my father, I said, Pop, I said, I got a job at Valentino's with the Gambinos. How'd you get that? I said, I just went there. And he says, they hired me. The phone rings the next day. We're all eating dinner. And back then at 5 o'clock, your mother, father, we all had dinner. So I pick up the phone and the lady says, is this Steve? Yeah, can you hold on? Joe Gambino wants to talk to you. Hello? Yeah, can you stop by tomorrow? I want to speak it to you. Like, I want to speak it to you. Hung up the phone. My father said, who is it? It's Joe Gambino. Well, what do you want? He said, he wants to see me tomorrow. For what? I said, I told you I want to be working here. I don't have no idea. I figure scheduling, pay, whatever. I go into the office. He sit down. He said, are you a Longer John's son? And I said, no, it's my uncle. He's a good man. He's a very nicer man. But we live next door to him. You want to work for me? Yeah. I pay you $100 a night. Drink all you want, but not stupid. I'll say thank you. Everybody, probably to this day, thinks my Uncle Raymond got me the job. Mm-hmm. I told my father, he said, go tell your uncle. So I had to go to 29th Street with the vending business. I told him, he says, that's great, good. You know, any issues, just let me know. So that's how I started my career. And think about it, I didn't know how to play music. Like, I just I tell people today, sometimes you got to fake it till you make it.
Sure.
So like I.
But you weren't afraid.
Yeah, I wasn't afraid. Cause, yeah. But
it was your opportunity.
If I played certain records, I would get the place going crazy. Then like I would turn all the lights up in the club. You don't do that. Joe and Sal, his brother Sal, they would look and say, "What's wrong? Nothing. Look at the people. They're going crazy." So that's how I got started in the music
business. That's awesome. How long did you do that for? Few years?
77 to 82. Okay. So I wind up working for Joe, and I love Joe. I still see Joe Gambino. He still comes to my restaurant in Florida. We still see each other. His brother Sal, who I adored, he lives in Sicily. I know Sal's son very well. We stay in contact. I'm still in contact, really, with everybody that was on the street. I'm friends with everybody. I'm friends with everybody. Everybody, if you know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Everyone, you got to stay friendly with
Absolutely.
Everybody. So I remember, it's a true story. I'm playing music, and then I got offered a couple, you know, other places to do. And Joe didn't like that. He wanted me to stay here. And then he said, I'm going to give you Friday and a Saturday. I said, what about my friend Joey? I'm not taking his place. That's not right, Joe. No, I do what I want to do. He's no good for it. He just plays. He don't look at the crowd. You get at the crowd crazy. I'm speaking broken English.
Right,
I love it.
So
he says, yeah. I said, Joe, I can't do that to him. He said, don't worry about it. I'm making sure it's good. Whatever he did, and Joe, he came over to me. He said, Steve, I got another job at another club. This is all yours. You all right with that, Joe? He says, yeah, I'm all right with that. Wow. So that's how I got spinning records. And I got in trouble. When you're on the street, you're going to get in trouble.
What kind of trouble?
Okay.
If you want to talk.
No, no. You know, I'm young, right? So I see a bartender, you know, and I wind up dating her. Not really dating her, just taking her, have some fun. And so one night we went out, we stayed overnight in a hotel, and I take her back to Valentino's about 8 o'clock in the morning. It's closed, but her car is here. I drop her off. All of a sudden, car comes next to me. Stops. Another car. Stops. Another one in the front. I saw my mother. It's a hit. They're going to kill me, whatever. And I hear her say, oh, shit, it's John. What the fuck's John? Some guy I was seeing. Six guys get out, two in each car. I'm standing here. I'm saying, what the fuck? So I'm going to be ready. We're going to go out, whatever. He opens the door, gets her out, and says to me, "Know my name, Steve. Get out of here before we break your legs. I'm not going to argue nobody, right?" Start the car. I took off. But I was always taught. My Uncle Raymond always taught me, you could always forgive but never forget. So I said to myself, I can't let this go. Guy threatened to break my legs. That's a threat. It still can happen. Now, at the time, my father was injured. He was delivering something to another vending place, and a 1,200-pound fence fell on him, broke both his legs. So he was recovering at home, so he couldn't really get out of bed. But I didn't want to. I wasn't the guy to go run to Raymond. I wasn't the guy to go run to my father. So he was downstairs. I went upstairs, and I called a friend of mine who was coming with me to work that night because I had to spin records at Valentino's. And my father must have. Back then, you had your phones, the wire. You know, so my father must have. He said to me, "You all right?" I said, "Yes." I said, "I'm fine. I'm going upstairs." And when you're on the phone, your mother would able, they would hold like, listen. They would listen, yeah. Right? I didn't notice. And I say to my friend, "I got an issue. There might be an issue tonight. Can you bring your friend tonight?" I'm talking about this. I didn't have it, so I knew he had it. He says, "Yeah, I got it." I hear, "Get down here." "Well, get down here." I go down, he goes, "What happened? What do you mean? What happened? I heard you on the phone. What happened?" I told him the story. And he says, "You never, ever put yourself in a position like that to jeopardize not just you, but your family. I'll take care of it." So when he said, "I'll take care of it," I didn't know what he meant. So he still took that with him. We go to work. And I remember walking through the door was Angelo, my uncle, and Sonny Rick and Benny. I'm talking about three major superstars, as far as I'm concerned.
Were you nervous now, seeing them coming through?
Yes. He says, "Oh shit, look who's at the front door. Now, Sonny always wore his coat, old school style, over his shoulders, never in his hands. They walked past the DJ booth, did not acknowledge me. I find out later that they had said to Joe, they said, "Where's Joe? Where's Joe at?" And Joe said, they called him. "I want him here now." This is what's told to me, right? What I'm now. They had a conversation. Joe knew the guy. He was a pizzeria guy. He knew the guy. They never asked for me or my side of my story. I told the story to my father. The girl never came to work that night. She never came to work after that. But a week later, I was at somebody's place, and my uncle was there. My uncle was the sharpest dresser in Philly, to the T, immaculate to the T. So my sister said to me, "Your uncle's here." "Well, where's he at?" "He's in the back." I went over, he see me, he says, "Called you kid. Come here, kid." He said, that problem you got's all straightened out. I said, "Yeah?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "We got him." He was brought to the office. And I don't forget these words. Like a baby, he crawled to my feet. He said, "This is how he did it. I've got more balls in my fingernail than that man's got." I said to him, "You should never threaten somebody, especially if you don't know who they are." Guy was pleading for his life. And I'm not saying that my uncle was going to do anything, but begged him not to hurt him. And he left, and that situation just went away. Now, did I look at that as a problem? No, I looked at that, it was great. Well, my uncle took care of something. That's power. I want that power. I would love to have that power. Just, you can get something done without raising your hand. That's respect, you know? So, again, playing music at different places and doing what I was doing, but then everybody was getting killed and everybody was going to jail, and I said to myself, but understand this, and we don't talk about this. I had a dream when I was a young kid that the Pope was calling me, this might sound crazy, called me from a plane. He was at the top of a plane. He was saying, "Come with me." And I remember waking up differently. I had to be 8 years old, 9 years old. I remember being done differently. So that was always in my life. There was a tug. There was always good, evil, good, evil, good, evil. Always was a tug. And I remember when I was younger, I made a little altar. Now, this is not Steve Martorano. You know, I went to Catholic school. I didn't go to confession. I wasn't, didn't think nothing of it. But I made an altar, and I just, there was something different happened to me. I never said this to anybody. I think I put it in my book, though. But I had thought for a while about being a priest. And it didn't go well with my father. "What are you kidding me? We're not priests. My mother, I'm her only son. She wanted grandchildren, right?" But there was something calling me. And this has happened 4 or 5 times in my life where God won. Today, he won. And so I let it go. And before you know it, you're hanging around your friends and doing stupid things. You're selling drugs. You're moving anything. You're taking cars. The cars are getting cut up, chopped up. You're making money. You put in your pocket. You're earning. You're getting some respect on the street. You're friendly with everybody. Everybody seems to like you. You seem to like them. You don't want to burn no bridges. You don't want to do any of that. So we were all friends. So I had money in my pocket. I forgot about the church. I forgot about God. But like when I lost, when everybody was going to jail, I said to myself, "Steve, you're not dumb. Are you going to go to jail or you're going to get killed? If you pick the wrong cycles," then there was a war. There was a war between the Rick and Benny's faction, right? It was a war. People were getting killed everywhere. I never saw that before, never heard that before. Right. And Rick and Benny was Sonny's son, was a good friend. He did something stupid to another good friend of mine. And before you know it, that kid gets killed, right? So what? It's like, what the fuck? Then poor Salvi gets killed. Let me tell you something. To me, Salvi Testa would have been a boss of bosses. He was born for that life. I could have never been that. You know why? Because I said to you, God touched my soul early. So you tell me something, I'm gonna feel something. You can't feel shit in that world. Mm-hmm. It's straightforward business, and that's it. Right. That's why I could be friendly with people. I could make some money, but I could never be a cold, cold gangster. It's not in my DNA. Fake it for a while, but when it comes to push and shove, I probably feel bad for the girl. If I'm gonna clip a guy, I'm probably, if he starts crying or being a baby, I'm gonna feel sorry for him. You don't want a guy like me on your side. So, but that pull with God came back. Always comes back when you lose, when you're down, and you're on your knees, and the only next place to look is up. And you say to yourself, you know, God, I can't do this no more. I mean, where am I headed? Wise guys are broke most of the time. Whatever, and that's sad, because I got that today in my life. No matter what I might have in a bank, I only go by what I got in my pocket. I'm only as rich as what I got in my pocket. Right. If I got $4 or I got $1,000, my mood will change. By $4, I won't be looking around. I got a dime, I'm the richest guy in the world. That's from coming from not having nothing, right?
Sure.
So, and that lifestyle, it was like, not everybody had money. All right, so what's the big deal? Well, the big deal was the respect and the honor, but that's not always how it works. There's greed and there's jealousy and there's whatever. But when God touches you, you could fight it for a while, but in the end, he wins. So what happens is, I started to read the Bible now. My father died 2 weeks before I got married. Everybody's in jail, I'm alone, my friends are all getting killed, I'm reading the Bible. I said, what do I do for a living? So I said, I don't know, I don't have no money. Why can't I start a takeout business out of my apartment? I'm talking to myself, I do that a lot. I talk to myself, when I start answering myself, then I know that, okay, there's an issue, but I talk to myself. I said, why don't I just get a flyer, Steve's Italian Kitchen, put a phone number on there. My uncle had a restaurant downtown, I use that address if someone was to ask me. And I put flyers in mailboxes, put flyers on the
hood, telephone poles.
Telephone poles, on the windshield of cars. Tell your neighbors, just call. I would go buy the lunch meat. I bought a slicer in the refrigerator. I'm in my apartment. It's illegal.
How old are you now? 25?
24. 24. So I said to myself, nobody knows I'm doing it. I don't have a delivery guy. If somebody calls for a hoagie, I'm still playing music a little bit. Nobody calls first week. Nobody calls the second week. Nobody calls the third week. I got this food. I got to throw it away. I got to go buy more. My mother's going, what are you doing? You're not making any money. It's costing you money. I just need one call, Mom. I just need one call. So I used to go to work in a three-piece suit. That was the day. I had my handkerchief, right? And I was a good dancer. Not to get off the subject real quick, but they had a dance contest to be part of Saturday Night Fever. And me and this girl, Francine, there was like 500 couples. We came in second. We came in second for that thing. But so I'm all dressed up, pressed out, cloned up, all over. I'm walking out the door, the phone rings. Ling, ling, ling. Steve's Italian Kitchen. Yeah, can I get two hoagies? Yeah. Where you live? Here's the address. Okay, thank you. I'm at the phone. I'm in a suit. I slice the lunch meat in my suit. I go to a guy's house in a suit. The wife answers the door. She says, can I help you? I said, I got two hoagies. This is how you deliver the hoagies. I said, no, but we're closing. Oh, you did that for us? Yeah, thank you. I gave it to her. The next day, same time, I call her. What was the nickname I have for her? Miss Wright.
Same people.
Miss Wright says, can I order two more hoagies? They were delicious. Boom, I said, I made the hoagies. Then another call. But understand, I didn't have nobody, right? So I had to make the sandwich. I had to take the phone off the hook, get into my car, drive to the house, come back, put the phone back on the house. So before you know it, there's a little business going. I had to hire a delivery kid. A friend of mine was a cop. Called me on the phone. Steve, whatever you're doing, get out of there. They're coming to shut you down. When? Sometime today. This was like 8 in the morning. We got a truck. I took a refrigerator and a slicer. That's all I had. They came. There's nothing here. I brought it to my mother's basement. So now I was able to have my mother answer the phone. My nanny wash the dishes in the pots. In the sink where the laundry. Remember we had a hose coming out of your laundry? Soap would come out the water. Yep. So she's washing them in there. I had a 4-burner stove, I would cook, I had a delivery guy. and I had a business for about 4 years.
That's
no great. Electric bill, no gas bill, no rent. It was in my mother's house.
She probably loved it.
But she loved it. I was always there. So I needed to make a move, right? So let's work. What can we do? So you got Southwest Philly, which had a lot of Irish, Polish. You had, I'm sorry, Southwest Philly. South Philly was, you know, in my area, my grandma's all Italian, but you had a little bit of mix. Then you had Northeast Philly, and you had North Philly. North Philly was a lot of black people, and Northeast was a lot of Jewish people. And I was always told that Jewish people keep Italian restaurants in business. So my first wife lived in Northeast Philly, and I had asked her out four times, and four times I canceled, because guys from South Philly don't go to Northeast Philly. We just don't go. There's just no reason to. No clubs, no restaurants, and I kept canceling. So I wind up doing it, and before you know it, she wind up being my wife. She's a beautiful person. Debbie's a beautiful person. Raised two great kids, well, Stephen and Joey. So I said, why not open up in Northeast Philly? But I'm a South Philly guy. But the Jewish people keep the restaurants in business. Why make them come to Philly? I'll be there. But I didn't know that they were used to spending $9.95 for soup, salad, dinner, and dessert. I didn't know that. So I wind up buying a house in Northeast Philly because that's where my business was. I bought and I had no money. Debbie worked at a bank. She had some money, so she really did it. Had a townhouse. But they built a shopping center in front of the townhouses. So there might have been 500 townhouses. So the shopping center wasn't on the street. Another mistake in my life. No direction. Nobody told me what to do. Nobody told me how to do it. Are you supposed to be asking me questions? Because all I'm doing is talking.
This is great.
So you got this little place, and they're half sold out. Some of them are empty, and it's a struggle. Nobody's coming in, or they are coming. But Debbie was working at the bank, so she had the income coming in. But I'm a man. I'm a woman going to pay my way. So I had an idea. I said, the summer's coming. Maybe we make water ice, do Italian water ice. There's nothing really up here. So I started an Italian water ice. But in Philly, all the water ice places are windows. You walk up to the window, you get a water ice. Here, you had to walk in. And I said to myself, I don't know, would it work? But it worked. And before you know it, it was all cash, nickels, quarters, dimes, 50 cents, 250. I saved $100,000. Wow. I'm a millionaire, right? Where I'm from, I saved $100,000. We need to buy something. Now, I guess I'm not that stupid. We should buy some property. I ain't got no credit. But if you know certain people can get certain things done with banks, and you have relationships, things can happen. So I bought something. Didn't know how I was going to pay for it, but I bought it. Only the luck of Steve Martorano is when he bought it, the day he's going to open up, he gets a letter saying the street's closed for 6 months. Under construction.
Six months.
Open my doors. Nobody can get to me. Oh. I got no money. So we opened the doors. We put some wood planks out. My customers who knew me would come. But I'm on the street. I get done work, go take a shower, go try to earn some money. You sell pills. You try to sell pills to earn. I'm not thinking a good or bad of pills because I got high. Wasn't a junkie, but I got high. So it was, and then back in the 80s, it was fun. If you had coke, you were a big shot. You weren't a junkie. If you had a 714, like a Valium, you weren't a junkie. You was part of a hip crowd. So I would earn. And the Iraqi war hit, and the economy got worse. Real estate just dropped in the 80s. It was like, what the fuck? What am I supposed to do? Just stay on the street? I got to sell this. Somebody's going to buy it. Before you know, nobody was coming in. So I had to close the doors. I got a mortgage to pay. I got a house to pay.
How hard was that to
you? Because you got no idea. Because the summer was just about to click. So I said, wait a minute. We could tell everybody we're remodeling the restaurant because we had a little window in the new place, which I owned. The other place, they had to walk in. This was a little window selling water ice through. So I would go there every day for a nickel, 25 cents, 50 cents, 75 cent cups, $1.25 cups, 250, 350 quarts. I'm scooping. People waiting in line around a corner for water ice. Nobody's asking me about the restaurant. Somebody would come, it's locked, they say, oh, we're remodeling. We weren't remodeling, I just wasn't gonna open up. I was making some money to help pay. I had two kids, plus the money on the street, just barely making it. One Sunday I got home and I said to myself, I gotta do something. I started with macaroni, meatballs, gravy. You open this place up with a little shishish, trying to be a little more hipper like LeBec Finn or the Saloon, but I still didn't know what I was doing. I don't know what I'm doing. Nobody taught me anything. So I said, let me go back to old school. So I put some flyers out. I changed the name from Steve's Italian Kitchen to Macaroni. So in my head, right, macaroni joints cheap, $6.25. Dish of macaroni, $6.25, $7.25. I didn't know no better. I didn't know what prices should be. Wow. I take a ride up to New York City. It's how my whole life changed. Never told nobody this story. It's how my whole life changed in cooking. I go to New York City. There's a place called Umberto's Clam House on Mulberry Street. I've never been to New York City, never ate in New York. You always told the best is in New York City. Me and Fat Frankie, I say it a lot, so I would always pound around them. We go to this place, it's a counter. You order clams and linguine, seafood. I'm sitting on the counter. I see these two guys open clams, shucked clams. I use Progresso clams in a can. That's what my mother used. I'm in a restaurant, I don't know about fresh shit like that. I pre-cooked my macaroni because my uncle had a restaurant and I used to watch them and they pre-cooked everything. And you find out that other restaurants all pre-cooked their pasta. We say macaroni and they dip it in the water, put it and throw sauce, we say gravy, that's how they would serve it. Did I like it? No, not as good as my mother's, right? So I go to Umberto's, I'm watching them guys, they're shucking clams to order. They're putting olive oil and garlic now. They're dropping, at the time, the Checo macaroni in the water with salt. They're doing it for me because I ordered it. And I eat it and I go, this is how a restaurant's got to run. You got to do this right. There was no internet, no YouTube back then. And I would just go every week or my day off to different restaurants, ask to go into the kitchen. How do you make marinara? Oh, you take the Italian tomatoes out of the can, you fry the oil and garlic. You don't make a pot like this for the week? Oh, no, that's not what we do.
Well, that's Steve, what we, this must have changed.
Oh, I went back to the restaurant and I told everybody, we don't do it like this. They all thought I was nuts. You can't cook macaroni to order. Why? There was no pasta cookers back then. You had to use pots, change the water. Sure. No, we're going to do this. And that moment, my life changed. I learned about tomatoes, olive oil, but no one had the balls or no one taught me. Excuse me. No one taught me shit, but that's all right. That's all right. It's all right, because when you're strong, you teach yourself. And I taught myself how to be good. I taught myself music, right? I taught myself how to be a great partier DJ, that I had a great name. And I said, I'm going to do the same in the food industry. And I start, now you got to understand, you might know something great, but if you're feeding somebody that doesn't know something great, it's hard. I still have them problems today. You know, there's a lot of restaurants out there like Olive Garden that people go and it's $5.95 and they want to know, why is my pasta dish $22? Well, just go taste the difference. And if you don't know the difference, don't even come to me, save your money, because you don't know the difference. Right. So I brought something to this brand, and understand this, no vision, no brand, no goals, had to pay bills. But I started a craft and I started doing things. Oh, you brown garlic? You don't chop garlic. You brown it. You throw basil and oil to fragrance it. You throw your, San Manzano tomatoes? I'm using Formanos. My mother used Formanos, crushed tomatoes. Red Pack, not red, but they're tomatoes. No, they're California. These are Italian tomatoes from Italy.
Quality.
What a difference. My mother didn't know that. My mother could only afford Formanos. Was my cooking better than my mother's? After I learned what I was doing. Before that, my mother's cooking was great for what she did. She could make a hot dog and throw peppers and onions in it.
Be delicious.
And be delicious. Right. We still do that.
Yeah.
But my mother would use Hunt's tomatoes, and it was good. Sure. But if I squeeze a Sierra Manzano tomato, it takes it to another level. So I taught myself how to... The Saloon, have you ever heard of it in Philadelphia? The Saloon was my mentor. I knew Richie Santor, who owned it. He still owns it today. He was a friend. I never had the balls, and I was never the guy that asked. I wasn't like, can you help me? I never asked. And my grandmother used to say, if you never ask, you never get. And my mother never asked. She never got. Everybody else got. In the family, everybody else got. My mother never got nothing. So I don't know what to believe. So I guess I was still that, just don't ask. Mm-hmm. I would get takeout from the Saloon. They wouldn't know it's me. And I'd send somebody in to get it, and I would open in the car, and I would look at the marinara, like how loose it is. I taste it. I would eat a dish of ravioli and taste it and try to figure out, you know. But then there wasn't no food magazines, but there was this Italian magazine called La Cucina in Italian. I didn't speak Italian, but I bought the magazine to look at the pictures. Mm. And if I saw a dish that I can make look like that, then maybe I could do it. So again, self-taught.
Yeah. No trial and error.
Trial and error.
Yeah.
To today, trial and error. So with that, the Iraqi war hit, I lost everything. I have to make a change in my life. I live in Jersey, I have a mortgage to pay, I can't pay it. If I sell the building, it's worth $800,000. Iraqi war hits, it's worth $175,000. I wind up working a deal out, I sell it, I wind up with $70,000. Paid whatever I had to pay, I think there was $35,000 left. And I'm not a business, like my first wife took care of all that stuff. She, not that she put me in debt on credit cards, but she had to pay them. She didn't want me to worry. What do I do? A South Philly guy named Ray Abruzzi went to Alabama school, college, played football. Why not playing for the New York Jets? Why not being best friends with Joe Namath? Wind up having a business with Namath called Bachelors 3, one in New York City, one in South Florida. I've been to Florida once or twice with Fat Frankie, that was his uncle. So I called him on the phone, I said, how you doing? He said, why don't you come to Florida? Get out of that South Philly mentality, cause you're a good cook, you cook great, do something here. So I only got X amount of dollars. Yeah, but the rent's not bad, you get a little shopping center. I said, okay, that's all I knew. So my first wife says, I have a friend that lives in Coral Springs. What's that? It's part of Florida. Really? We can go there for the weekend. We go for the weekend. They take me around Coral Springs. They're taking me to pizzerias that have dinners, but they're pizzeria joints.
Yeah.
I'm saying, this is all they got? But wait a minute, it's 9:00. They're all closing. I want to be open till 11. I don't go out to eat till 9:30. Now, this ain't for me. True story. It's not for me. We're leaving the next day to get on a plane to go back home. If I don't make this call, I'm not sitting here. Mm-hmm. No way in hell. I'm dead. I'm in jail. Or I'm a truck driver. Whatever. I call Ray on the phone. I said, cuz, I'm sorry I don't have time to see you. I'm leaving. He says, where you at? So I'm in Coral Springs. What the fuck you doing there? Well, it's a family place. There's kids. My kids got to grow up in school. What do you want me to go, Fort Lauderdale? There's no schools in Fort Lauderdale. My kids got to play with kids. Stop being a jerk off. You can live there, but why don't you open up here? Well, I'm leaving in an hour for the airport. Before you leave for the airport, come to Oakland Park at A1A. It's a little joint across the street. I know it's closed. They close every year for 3 months. I know it's for sale. Go take a look at it. I don't have time. Do it for me. I drive, get out of my car. I look in the window, 5 tables, 800 square feet, 700 square feet. This is for me.
Wow.
This pink awning. Pink awning.
But you felt it.
Yes. I said, this is for me. I call him on the phone. I says, I like this. Okay, go home. Let me get in touch with the realtor. I'll put you in touch with him. Go home, talk to the realtor, find out it is for sale. I ain't got the money to pay the guy. They were kind enough to take a little bit of money and pay them off. They had plans on opening a bigger place because they were so successful. So I wound up getting a house in Carl Springs, which was an hour away. A little bit of money down. I had to give him a little bit of money. When I tell you, cuz, I had maybe $4,800 left. Ray had an uncle who helped paint the place. I fed him. I couldn't pay him. I opened my doors with $40. That was it. One credit card. And since I was in debt before with the credit card, I didn't want to go on it. And we put a sign, South Philly Cooking. Now, I knew I had support from Uncle Ray because he had friends. They would come and support me. Five tables. And I was cooking by myself. My mother was a hostess. We had no bar. It was beer and wine.
She moved down with you?
Yeah. My mother, like I said to me, lived with me.
That's right.
All my life. My father died, lived with me. Moved her to Florida, lived with me. All. Never alone from my mother to now. So I just started to do my cooking. But when I took the business from the guy who had a great business, all his macaroni was all pre-cooked. And I'm saying to myself, you know, right off the bat, I got to be better than this. All his stuff came in cans, and he was busy. And I'm saying to myself, how could you be busy with this product? If you're busy, I should be packed. So I told him what I was about to do, and he laughed in my face. You're going to fail here. They don't care. They just want cheap prices. The way you're going to do it, you got to be a little bit more higher. I said, this is all I know. This is what I'm going to do. And it's the first two nights, $50, $60, but I'm not losing no money because I'm really the only payroll is me. We had no dishwasher, had to be washed by hand. I run back there, wash some dishes, give them back. The weekend came, a little bit more money. So I went up taking $20 out of register because my father used to say to me, you got to go support all the bars. In Philly, we have bars, not nightclubs really. So you go to a bartender, tip him, well, he'll send people to you. So Debbie says to me, it's $20, what are you doing? I'm saying, I gotta go out and meet people. So I get a glass of wine, it's $3.25 difference. I give to the bartender. It's for me, yes, for you. I said, I just opened up a restaurant from South Philly. Oh, those two bartenders are there from South Philly. You should go say hello to them. So I'm drinking, I'm sipping, it's empty. I don't wanna look like a jerk off enough, I got no money. I go into the bathroom, put on the sink. Now I got water, so it looks like wine. It's dark. I go talk to the two boys. Where you from? Oh, I know your cousin Andy. I know him. Before you know it, then they'll send some people, and it started to get a little better, a little better, a little better. Then Will Chamberlain came in. Never had any superstar. My superstars was Angelo Bruno, my uncle,
right,
and Phil Testa. They were my superstars. So he came in. I cooked for him. He loved it. Gave me a basketball. Gave my mother, took a picture of my mother. We put it up on the wall. My first celebrity, Will Chamberlain. And then Tony Bennett, I was in the gym working out, and one of my waiters, only had one waiter, says, Tony Bennett wants to come in and eat, but they're looking for a deal. I said, they're looking for what? Looking for a deal. I said, well, I tell you, tell them to give me 12 tickets, first front row. Give me a deal, I'll give you a deal. So I don't think they're going to do that, Steve, but they want a deal. I said, tell them, I just started out. There's no deal. And that's Tony Bennett. I knew it could help me. I said, I can't afford it. Say no. Calls me back. Calls me back and says, they want to know if they can get a deal on the liquor. Now, I know Tony Bennett's not asking for a deal. Right. It's his road manager, right. Or whoever it is. I said no. Well, they said they can go up the street. But anyway, they came. They sat down. They ate. He had occhetti with broccoli rabe. He tells me, people can tell me anything. Unless I see you back in that seat, then I know it's true. People say it's good, but they don't want to hurt your feelings. But he's a traveler, so he could never have been one. But he did send another guy in. And that was like the first time of celebrities coming in.
And when is this now? The 90s? Where are we?
92.
That's when it opened.
Yeah, 92. Five tables. And this interview is not long enough to get into what has happened from deaths, murders, just shit that has happened in the area. It just seems like a guy from Philly, I guess, attracts. My mother used to say to me, where you find them? Only my son would find these guys. I don't know if it just says, I don't know, trust this guy or whatever. But I always wind up being attracted to other guys. Who's from Sheepshead Bay, who's from Brooklyn, who's from Boston. So before you know it, because I'm back, I'm doing a legit thing, I'm praying, but I'm back on the street. I'm back out on the street. I start to see how I can make a little bit more money. Again, I'm not really making money in the restaurant. And before you know it, a couple of things had happened. A couple of guys I knew had gotten killed. Now I'm in Florida. It's happening now. I'm going, what the fuck am I doing? It's not going to work. And my first wife and me weren't really seeing eye to eye because I was on the street. You know, she wanted a different life. And then I met my wife now, Marcia. And I met her, and I was still on the street. She knew about me, and you know, she would come look for me. I'd be in a club. Get out of here. Leave me alone. But the next day, right, where do you go? Put your head down, you say, I'm sorry. You get sick and tired of saying you're sorry, right? So, we gotta backtrack. Please, just backtrack for a second. Before I take the trip to Philly, to Florida, I find out my uncle's coming home. I'm already reading the Bible. I lost all my friends. They were laughing at me, making jokes, holy roller. Some of my family members making jokes, holy roller. But I was committed to God. And I prayed and I gave my life to Jesus. But again, my Uncle Raymond, who I loved and adored, had an opportunity to come home. So he asks me to visit him and grade for prison. So. But he also tells me to bring him a couple sandwiches. So I stick the sandwiches in my sock. I stick it down my pants. They didn't really check you, like frisk you that bad. So you go in, you're feeding them, you're seeing them. Haven't seen them for a while. I'm coming home, and I want you to be with me. And I'm sitting there. And it's my uncle who I love and adore. And I love God, too. So, push, here we go. I want you with me. I'm coming home. Nothing to think about, he says. Right? Nothing to think about. I said, right, nothing to think about. I'll see you here next Friday. I leave and go back. He starts to talk to me. I'm coming home. I want you to drive me around, bring him the sandwiches and all this. I need you to send these two messages. Now, I know you always killed. The messenger always gets killed, right? I said, Uncle, I really don't want to be a messenger. What do you want me to do? You want me to call him on the phone? I said, no. Gives me a message. I relay the message. I come back. I give him the message. I get another message. Now I'm getting drawn in. He goes, he's coming home. What did that mean to the streets of Philadelphia? I don't know. Did he put his time in? Did he keep his mouth shut? Was my uncle an earner? He made a cover of a major magazine. Want to be, say, being one of the wealthiest gangsters ever. Yeah, my uncle had money. He was an earner. But I loved him dearly. And so now I'm in the middle, and I'm saying, what can I tell you, God? I'm in it. Now your mind doesn't think of shit. You think of bad shit, whatever you got to go do. You got to go see this guy, make sure that message is right, because if you mess up the message, you got in it, you got a problem. Maybe it's how God works, though, but. And it got overturned. He wasn't coming home. Mm. We were all ready for him to come home, but he didn't come home. So I said, maybe that's a sign. Maybe moving to Florida. That's when I moved to Florida, because he wasn't coming home. And I kept God in my life, and I found this place. Wow. But now I'm back on the street with New York guys. A couple guys are getting whacked, and it's like, where am I at? And then Marcia came into my life and she said to me, you're going to lose everything you got and me if you don't get out of this nightlife. Now, when you're in this nightlife club growing up, I never drank at home. I never drank. I never went to a corner bar. But if I went out Friday and Saturday night, I'm drinking. If it hits 6 o'clock, I want to do a bump. I'm gonna keep going until like 7-8 in the morning. I'll go home, sleep for an hour, and go to work. I never miss work. I don't care how drunk I was, how high I was, I would go to work. It was instilled in me. And I was out one night. I never was out for a day and a half. I was out partying for a day and a half. I never ever did that. And we were closed, so I was safe for that day. She came in and she found me. Don't ask me how she found me. She just said to me, I'm gonna leave, you're gonna lose everything. And that was 9 years ago. I'm clean and sober nine years.
Wow, congratulations. Yeah. So she was your saving grace.
Yeah. I think God had a plan and put that person in my life for that. Now she's Jamaican, I'm Sicilian. We both got the same color. You know what I'm saying? It's just Sicily's been conquered by the Moors and by everybody. Yeah. So I got that soul in me. Like
but her. Let's talk about that, Steve, because a lot of people don't talk about interracial marriages or just racism in general. I don't understand why people see color. I just don't.
They don't understand.
Well, we weren't brought up that way.
No, we were brought up that way. You were brought up in the 60s. I went to 70s, an all-white grade school, and the first black girl came in, it was eighth grade, and it was like a big deal, a black girl was coming to the eighth grade. Living in South Philadelphia, you had a black section and a white section. The black section was the projects. That's all you knew, it was projects. Didn't know about, had money, no money, it was projects. You lived in your house here. There was territories. You always said to yourself, if you ever walked into the project, they always say you'll never come out. Well, that was where the black people lived. You walked in my neighborhood, you're never going to come out. But every summer, with the heat, there was arguments. They would stay, the blacks would stay, throw bottles at us. Mm. Just stupid stuff. We're not, never out to hurt. Just throw bottles up in the air, they'd smash it. The neighbors would watch. It would be like entertainment at nighttime in their beach chairs in a summer night.
Right.
But what changed, and I never had any anger. I never felt any prejudice. I thought Martin Luther King was great. I'm a strange cat, bro. I'm strange. These things affect me differently. I would listen to Martin Luther King speeches over and over growing up.
Oh, so inspirational.
Yeah. But not. I couldn't tell that to Joey Eyes, because he's going to laugh at me, mm-hmm. you know? So, and we had our names for each other that we would call and yell, but I knew I wasn't racist. Certain guys in my neighborhood would lay for a guy. You know, they would lay for a black kid come and try to give him a beat. And they would always ask me to come, and I wouldn't go. I didn't understand, how do I? Listen, I one time, like I said, my father said, what's he going to be? I wanted to be a fighter. And in Philly, you know, there was a gym called Juniper Gym, and I had a manager called Nick Ferrillo. And guys would come from other neighborhoods that want to fight me in the street, like corner guys would want to fight me. So it wasn't that I didn't know how. Well, I hit somebody, I really hurt somebody. It's not a business. Like, I'm not boxing as a profession. Why am I going to hit a black kid? Well, he didn't do nothing to me. Right. So when I went to high school, it was black and white. And I said to myself, there's some big-ass black kids here. If there's ever going to be a beef, I'm going to make sure that I'm friends with some of them big kids. And there was one black kid, his name was Cheesy. I heard about him. I just walked up to him. I said, you Cheesy? He said, yeah, what do you want? I want nuts. We'll tell you, I'm Steve Montarana. You want to come home and have lunch with me? And he looked at me like I had five heads. You want to take me home for lunch? Yeah, you want to come home for lunch with me?
That's
what's your mother make her? I don't know. We got to ask her. And I took him. And my neighborhood's white. When I say neighbors, looking and looking, my mother saw me coming, right? She opened that screen door. 2 years? So I would bring somebody home. 2 years, yeah. Cheesy came in, sat at my table. We had lunch together. Wow. We became friends, and I became friends with other
his friends,
black people. Mm-hmm. But understand, my grandmother's neighborhood, where I said there was Italians, there was also some black. And I remember them you would sit outside. The Italians would sit outside and beach chair. And they would pass my grandmother, and they would say, good morning, Miss Mary. Good afternoon, Miss Mary. And I would say to their grandmother, good morning, good afternoon. So in that neighborhood.
Respect.
But in my other neighborhood, we were always fighting with the projects. And I was one way, then I go home another way, but I was never that one to throw a bottle. I was never that one to go up the driveway and give a guy a beating. I some guys might have think I was weak. I just didn't think it was right, you know? So meeting Marcia was, I never saw no color. I really didn't see no color. And how I met her was she was waiting for a, she was standing by a wall waiting for a takeout, but I didn't know it. I just walked in and I just said, are you waiting for dinner? She had a miserable look on her face. She says, but there's no tables. I'm getting a takeout. That's not what the fuck I asked you, just like that. She looked at me, who are you? Don't matter who I am. You want to eat? She says, yeah. So I sat her at the bar. I just kept sending her food over. She says, now I'm a DJ, right? So I incorporate music and food in my restaurant. So just to stop there for a second, I got to get this out there. Everybody's restaurant today in any part of this country, there's a nightclub inside a restaurant. If there was one 28 years ago, tell me, because I started that 28 years ago. So I'm the cook and I'm spinning. I'm playing a lot of slow jams.
And she's at the bar.
I'm romancing this motherfucker because I got romancing her. I'm just wanted to get to know her. I send her food and give her no check. I gave her a CD. Now she'll tell you a different story. I gave her a CD with my phone number on it. And she said she tried to call, but it was the wrong number. I don't believe that. But then she came back in for dinner, and she came in. We just started to talk, and that's history. But I never saw color. I never saw color. And you know, I people stare at it sometimes. Desgraciado, the Italian would say disgrace. I'm sure some black people would say, why don't you stay with our own kind? I said, what kind? We're all human beings.
Right.
We're all the same.
And that's it. So what can we do as a country, as a world community, to get past this?
I think we've come a lot further than where we were. I think some people, it's easy to point the finger and blame hierarchy, lowarchy, color. It's as simple as all starts here. Starts with you. If you're a racist, that's instilled in you. You got to change yourself. I always said this. If there was a burning building, a black guy or a white guy is trapped. A black or a white guy is sticking his hand out to help you. Are you going to say, what color are you? You're going to hold on to that arm, pull you out, and kiss and hug that person for saving your life. But Martin Luther King had a dream, a vision. There's some detours, but I think there are the young people today. I don't think the young people they are doesn't see the color. There's a lot of people intermingling.
So you have hope.
Oh, that's one thing. Padre Pio said, "Pray, hope, and never worry."
Why Padre Pio?
That's my guy. That's my guy.
Where did that come from, Steve? Were there pictures in the house? What?
I really.
I see your posts all the time.
Yes. I wish I would have.
Inspiring.
Yeah. I wish I would have met him. Everybody should do some research because he's a modern day saint, Padre Pio. Modern, our today's modern saint. He just had so many things. So there have been so many cures. He has interceded with the Blessed Mother to he's been beat up by the devil. See, we can sit here talking about Satan and the devil, and people say, what's he talking about? Satan, what's that? It's good and evil. Nobody can see good and evil in anything. Well, that's God is good, the devil is evil. That's what it is. And just read his life story. It'll change your mind. And what was great about, he had a thing called biolocation, that he could be in one place and be somewhere else. No, we're talking here, and there's people probably going to look at this and say, these guys are a little wacky. What are they smoking? It's about faith, right? And I know that there's a God. I know that there I know that Jesus Christ came and died for us. Which is the greatest gift in the world. You're seeing Christ love. Now, that's love, real love. Without real love, you have nothing. Everything else is fake. So what you see, emotion, is don't, I'm not, I say it all the time, I ain't no punk. I'll go back to back with anybody. But when God, when you touch his garment, you feel his love. Your life will change so much. Words cannot ever express what God really is. And all God said to us was, love one another as I loved you. Forget about rules and regulations. Love others as I loved you. If you do that, that's a good world, I think.
And it seems this is what you're bringing to everything you do. Wherever you go, all these places that you've opened, well, that's how it's all happened, right? I mean, how proud are you to be sitting here in the middle of this massive...
I never really talked. I talked about God a little bit on Steve Harvey. I made a promise to my Lord and Savior that I never chased money. I never chased money. I always knew that if you were good at something, money would come. I never made money a god. I always gave. If I had a dollar, you needed 50 cents, excuse me, I give you the 50 cents. I always gave. And it's hard. The internet now can put people in touch, good and evil. It could be evil and very bad for you, or it could be good and very helpful. I said, dear Lord, if you can help me grow this brand, we're always trying to bargain, right? We're always trying to bargain. You know, if you cure my grandmother, I'll go to church every, if you do, that's the worst thing you should do. You should always pray for others. Don't ask for nothing for you. He already knows what your needs are. Put others first. He'll take care of you. So I said to myself, dear Lord, if you give me an opportunity to grow this brand and help people, I'll put you first. So I did it on the Steve Harvey. It's hard for me to talk about God without crying. And I know it's just hard. It's hard to talk about that. It's hard to talk about my kids struggling and my mother. Those three things. So let's get myself back. So I told God, you do that for me. And that's what I did. So I put like a prayer on Instagram. I said, yo, cuz, if you need prayer, let me know. I don't want to know your name.
I saw that.
Right. I don't want to know. If you want to give me a story, I promise you I read it. And before you know it, two people would say, Steve, I'm having difficulty. And I read it. And I say my rosary every night. And there are some times when I miss it and you feel like shit when you miss it. And I put everybody's intention in that prayer. Before you know it, 5 or 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15, and I say tomorrow, there's a lot of people hurting.
Yeah. And how good does it make you feel to be able to...
Fuck the feelings, man. And listen, when you show this, don't judge God through my cursor. I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. When I say things how I come from my heart. But there are so many people hurting. You just want to help them. And I said, you give me that, I'll give you all the glory and all the praise. So that's where we're at. And my goal is to one day have a television show to help guys that feel like shit, been told no, don't have anything. There'll never be nobody and say, cuz, look at me. So if I can do it, you can do it. You don't have the resources, make the resources. Never give up. Never stop believing in yourself. But if he's not the center of your life, whatever you get will be taken away from you. So if I lose everything, I'll never lose him. I'll always be rich. So whatever comes to me is a bonus. It's a bonus. We don't deserve his love. We are born with sin. We didn't ask for it. We are born with sin. And I sin probably 1,000 times a day. The greatest news about sin is you ask for forgiveness. By his blood, we're forgiven. But it's all good, guys. Yeah. It's all good.
Wow.
I can't cry all the time,
no,
man.
No, it's okay.
It's not good. It's not good. It's a sign of weakness sometimes.
But look, this, the reason we're doing this, it's in our name. We are American Real because this is real stuff. We're dealing with.
Real.
People have real problems. Well, people want you to pray for them because they
power prayer. Power prayer is I seen things that could never happen if it wasn't
without
for
it.
Prayer.
That's right.
You know, people see my life. They see me on TV, and I've been on a lot of shows. They see my success in restaurants. Success is not measured by money. It's not measured by money. It's not measured by what you have. Success is measured by your character, and you could have nothing and still be successful. But what I did learn is that what I have to continue to fight for. I've told you through this interview, no one has given me shit. I am a third-class citizen in the food world. For the celebrities that are out there that all have shows, and they all deserve them, and they're all great at what they're doing. I'm still that Steve Martorano that's saying, how do I spin a record? How do I cook the right dish of macaroni? How do I run a restaurant? How? It's a fight. It's an everyday fight to keep what I got. Most of the other people can cruise because they at where they're at. I still have to fight for what is mine. And I would never deviate from the brand. We are. Every brand, every restaurant has the Blessed Mother and Padre Pio in it. If a brand where I was told me I couldn't have it, I would not do the deal. Offer me $100 million, I would not do the deal. If that's my faith, and that's if that offends somebody, don't come in.
Yeah. Let's talk about food a little bit, because I'm sure people want to hear about food.
So, come on. Look, you had some questions about your grandmother. See how?
That's right. So, but before we go there, let's if we went out to dinner, my wife Sabrina, and you and Marsha, and we were to sit down and eat.
Who's paying?
I'm paying.
Okay.
You could order whatever you want.
That would never happen. Right off the bat.
You could order whatever you want.
I have never let, very rarely, maybe twice in a lifetime, that anybody pay for my dinner when I go out with them. And there's a reason. It's not like because I got it and you don't have it. You would understand when I say to you what happens when you go out. So you're taking me out and you're paying. You're paying. Whatever restaurant it is, Mexican, Chinese, Italian, or steakhouse, I would probably order every appetizer. If it's Italian, every macaroni dish, every one. If there's a special, give me that too. I might not order an entree because I'm a macaroni guy. I'm not really a veal chop guy. I'm a chicken cutlet guy, broccoli rabe guy, veal parm, that. But I'm ordering all that. Now, you're taking me to dinner. Now, I know you'll be drinking, saying to yourself, oh, what's this going to cost? So I already paid the bill. I give the guy the card. So that's what helped. But I would order everything.
And you're not kidding.
Oh, no. On my hand to God. If it's Chinese, I'll order things. I'm going to ask what they are because if they're in Chinese.
And why are you doing it? You want to taste all the...
I just want to taste, right? I just want to taste flavor. And I say to them, most of the time they think I'm a food critic, right? That's what happens. Most of the time, which is kind of good, I'll take it home, but I'll give it to if there's a homeless guy, we'll give the leftovers to them, or the parking guy, we'll give it to them. So I'll taste and I'll just push it to the side, you know?
That's awesome. So you're always working, even when you're out for dinner.
Because I'm in bed. Thank God for YouTube. That's like my self-teacher, because I look at other people doing something, and I try to tweak it a little bit, you know, for me.
So what are some of your specialties? What do you love to cook most?
I started out just making hoagies, Italian hoagie. Some people call them subs.
So you make a mean hoagie.
I make a lunch, excuse me?
You make a mean hoagie.
I make a hoagie called the 9th Street Special, which was prosciutto, Genoa salami, sharp provolone, roasted peppers, olive oil, a little bit of oregano, and that's it. Tomatoes, if I get Jersey tomatoes, forget it. I make a great cheesesteak, and I tell people don't compare my cheesesteak to Philly's because I'm from Philly. Mine's is a home style, it's completely different.
What's different about it? Because I love cheesesteak.
Yeah, we mix. Most places in Philly, you get your bread, they put the cheese, either cheese whiz or American or provolone on the bread, then they take the hot steak and onions and put it. That melts it. My mother used to mix it all together. That's how we do it in the restaurant. So that's the home style.
Okay.
But I got famous for meatballs and salad and the Sunday gravy. To me, was no normal. I knew it was better than everybody, my neighbors, like they were making, my mother's and my grandmother's. They both made it basically the same because my mother learned from my father's mother. And the gravy was always pig's feet and pig skin and spear ribs and beef bourguignon and all that flavor. And everybody thinks all meatballs are the same. And I try to tell people, 90% of restaurants make a meatball and they put it in a tomato basil sauce, marinara sauce. They just let it simmer. I put it in that Sunday gravy. That's what brings it to the level that Gourmet Magazine said might just be the best meatball in the world. So I'm always criticized on the meatballs with who puts raisins, who puts pine nuts. That's not saying it's better, it's just different. But if you were brought up that way, I ain't got no right to say mine's is better than yours. It's the way you like it. But if you came to my restaurant and you're at that 40, 50, 60 age, I will bring you back to a time when you walked into your mother, grandmother's house and you smell that. Yeah.
What about the fried meatball?
Seems like that's my wow. Hidden secret. I'll take grandmother's house, mother's house.
Yeah.
Fried meatball, sliced bread, Hellman's mayo. I'm as happy as could be.
That's all you need.
Go to my grandmother's house, my other one, fried meatball, Italian bread, and pour the gravy over the fried meatball. So I had two versions.
Nice.
You know? But if I had to pick one, probably the fried meatball mayo. I like that.
That's good. That's good. Can we talk about a couple of peasant dishes my mother-in-law makes?
Okay.
I want to see if you've heard of these.
Can I just want to see my son?
Of course.
Can he come on?
Absolutely. Come here, buddy. You could hold him.
I am.
Yeah.
Come here, Pop.
So what's your dog's name?
Pio.
Pio.
Makes sense. Padre Pio.
Has a little bit of the look.
Yeah, doesn't he?
That's great. Pizza foy. Have you heard of pizza foy?
Spell it.
Pizza foy. But what it is?
F-O-R?
What it is. I think it's F-O-I, but what it is, it's broccoli rabe with fried polenta, but it's almost, the polenta's made like a pizza in a frying pan, hard.
Okay.
And then you break it up and you put it into the broccoli rabe with beans.
No, sir.
It's delicious.
Probably is, but you should write a book.
Okay, I'm gonna send these to you.
Okay.
Maybe you can make them someday. How about spinach with egg?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
We call it with sauce or
right. We've done that.
How about they call it huevo el sugo, which is egg in the sauce.
Right. Well, some people would call it eggs in purgatory
if they
put a little hot
pepper. Do you do that?
Not us, cuz.
You don't
where,
do
where
that.
Where you from? Where did you grow up at?
This is Abruzzi.
Okay, so you're Abruzzi. Where did you grow up at?
Well, I grew up in New York. Upstate.
So you're in New York.
Upstate New York.
There's a big line, like I told you,
sure.
What I learned cooking in New York really got me to where I'm at.
Yep.
You had rice balls,
yep.
We never had rice balls.
Right.
You had mozzarella carrozza, we never had that,
right.
You know, there. So,
keep
going.
Okay. And then cheese balls. Instead of a meatball, a cheese ball.
Okay.
You ever had that? And fried.
Like a mozzarella kind of?
No, like Parmesan. It's so like a meatball.
How they get it firm? Put water into it, or
it's a lot of cheese, okay. And I think bread. I think bread
cheese
is what holds it.
Okay, yeah. I like to try that one. Yes. Small.
Just like a small meatball, like
okay,
this.
Okay. Okay. No sauce, no gravy. Just pop it like a rice ball. Kind
exactly.
Of thing. Okay.
It's delicious.
Does anything ooze
no.
out?
Nope.
No?
Okay. Dry like a meatball.
Okay. Parmesan or Romano?
I'll get the recipe for you. Okay. I think it's Pecorino Romano.
Yeah, Locatelli, they would say.
Yep. And then just peas and rice in with sauce.
We had some rice dishes. We never had risotto. That was never part of my...
Right.
You want to laugh?
Yeah.
About rice? I don't know. Did you eat everything every week the same? Okay, Sunday was a pot of gravy. Mm-hmm. You didn't have an alarm clock to wake up. The smell of the fried meatball, that would wake you up. We never had eggs, never had bacon. You had your fried meatball, pop about six of them, or you made this sandwich. Soup was on Monday. Tuesday was leftover gravy, but with a different cut of macaroni. See, that's the difference. People say, you ate gravy 3 days a week? Yeah, but it didn't taste the same.
Right.
My mother would send me, go get a pound of macaroni with rigatoni, percetelli, fusilli, whatever I liked. That's what I would get.
Yeah.
Every cut, texture was a different flavor. And then Wednesday, my mother would do chicken cutlets. She would do broccoli, but I loved rice-a-roni. So she would make chicken rice-a-roni with a chicken cutlet. Yeah, yeah. Veal was too expensive, so we couldn't have that. Thursday was another cut of macaroni with the... But Friday was either Progresso clams or macaroni. If it was around Lent, we would have regular fish, pasta and cheese, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But Saturdays would be my mother's day off. So we would order sandwiches or get a pizza or something.
Sure, you take a lot of pride in your ingredients.
Some people will think a little bit more than I should, but... I always believe that Italian food is not about technique, it's about ingredients. Yet, that could be kind of false because of what I said to you earlier. My mother took a green pepper that has no flavor, a can of Hunt's tomato sauce that it's not for me, it's like paste.
But she would flavor it, right?
Make it taste like filet mignon. So maybe I don't have that talent that she has. But I do know better quality oils, better quality dry macaronis. You go to a store today, you can buy pasta for $0.88, $1.29. You can buy stuff for $9.99. It's the bronze dye, how the macaroni is extruded from there. The longer a dry macaroni takes, the better it is. So something that cooks 3 minutes, 5 minutes,
no. You don't want that.
You want that 12, 13, 14, 20, 25 minutes. That's the best quality.
And Steve, all of your restaurants doing the same thing?
All of them.
Everything made to order.
Everyone. That's why they're all open kitchens. If you don't think we cook your macaroni to order, just go look at it. Just come up front and take a look at it.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible. So... if you can, walk us through, if someone has not been to any of your restaurants, we want to get as many people there as we can in any of these locations, we'll post all your locations, what can they experience? What would the experience of a night out at Martorano's be?
Okay. There's two kind of atmospheres, and there has been a misconception of what it is. Because if you and your wife or a business partner, or you're making a big deal, right? You want Italian food, you heard Martorano's is great. If you came in at 6 o'clock, you would listen to Frank Sinatra, Tony Bennett, Dean Martin, some Italian music at a very low ambiance. The TVs would probably be playing a black and white movie like On the Waterfront, From Here to Eternity.
And this is at any of the restaurants?
Yes, Requiem for a Heavyweight, black and white, James Cagney, that kind of thing. Till about 8-ish, 9-ish, the music might get a little louder, but not where you couldn't have a conversation. The movies might turn to Bronx Tale, Goodfellas, Once Upon a Time in America, might turn to that. But when 9:30 comes around, the music gets a little louder. Because when you walk in, you'll see big speakers like a nightclub. So it's an entertainment experience. We touch all senses. If that same business meeting that you were come to at 6, you came at 9:30, or you came at 9, starts to change in a half hour. So you're trying to sell a deal. Now it's a nightclub. You're saying, where the hell am I at? And it'll be a very bad experience for you.
Okay.
But if you're coming for the nightlife and you come at 6, it becomes a bad experience for you too. Where's the music? So that fine line is around 9, 9:30, if you're looking for a nightlife, nightclub, dance, have fun, it's after 9:30 and before. If you want to have a business meeting or romantic dinner, then you come before that. But if, like I said, if you read our reviews, the most part is, I couldn't hear myself talk. Well, in most of the restaurants, especially Fort Lauderdale, if they really want to come out late, but they don't want all the whoopla, don't bring an ear plug. You'll see people with earplugs, but still enjoying your food.
And what time are you serving to?
12 o'clock. Yeah, 12 o'clock. Here I think it's 11, but 12 o'clock in Fort Lauderdale. But my whole life was started out with what? Music.
Yeah.
So every restaurant has a DJ booth, right?
Yeah.
And how it started 28 years ago in Florida was, I love music, I love movies, and there was nobody coming in my door, so I would play the sounds of Philly. I'm watching The Godfather or on TV, and I was happy, right?
Right.
Somebody came in, and then I never forget the first time was Dan Marino, the quarterback, and his wife. I know I said to you, Walt Chamberlain was the biggest Larry, but it was Marino, really. And his wife asked me for a CD. Can I buy a CD? And I said, I don't have no CD, it's just me. She said, well, is that you? You're running? Like, of course, the CD player was in the back, and I would be cooking, and I would go run back and press a button to change the song.
Okay.
And then before you know it, I put bigger speakers. My speakers started out like this. Now they're $350,000 to put into a restaurant.
And what made you want to incorporate it right there at the bar? Did it just click to say I need to do it right here?
Yeah, because I knew that I wanted to go out and have fun.
Yeah.
Most people were going out to have dinner and then leaving to go somewhere else, you know? So, and I want to make a statement here because it just came into the light about something, but it wasn't a restaurant. Maybe I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, I apologize. When I worked for the Gambinos at Valentino's, they had a restaurant and a nightclub. So, but it was always known as the nightclub,
separate.
Not the restaurant,
right,
you know? So maybe since I worked that, and that's what, I was used to that. So when I went to open my other place, it just corporate. So maybe I'll give that to Joe Gambino and Sal.
Well, they say, look, all of our experience make us who we are.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
So all those things that you did from a young guy.
It still is in my life.
It's in your
blood.
It's
my personality.
Yes.
You go to any of my places, you'll see Steve's personality,
wow.
You know? And I don't, there's a lot of people like would love me to come over. Like when I go to a place, I don't sit at the bar. I don't sit at people's table. I don't hang around people just to have a conversation. It's business to me. I'm not here for pleasure. I go to my kitchen. And I tell people, I never told nobody no if they wanted to take a picture with me. I don't know why, but they wanted to take a picture. Just to come back to the kitchen, we'll step out, we'll take a picture. Because when I go out, I get pulled. Now, once I get pulled to a table, I can't get back into the kitchen to see what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So some people, like, they get mad at me, like, why won't he come to my table? I'll try to explain to you, this is why. Just come to the kitchen. Mm-hmm. I'll take all the pictures you want, you know? But you're right, my whole personality is in all. Marcia said, if you don't get it, you'll never get it. So if you don't get what we're about, we're probably the most ridiculous restaurant group ever. But if you get it, the word genius has been said to me more than once, which I know I'm not, but has been said to me more than once. So it's that much of a difference.
Well, that's such a compliment because I agree. I mean, because what you've done is you've created something so unique, but it's you.
Yes.
You brought your personality to these restaurants that people love to experience. And I hope you're able to open more of these over time.
With God behind me, yes. But I only want to do places that are that fit the brand. Not every place fits the brand. This is a perfect fit, Jersey. Vegas has been a little rougher on me because it's the West Coast, but and the nightlife is not as strong as I would like it to be. Mm-hmm. Not like here or Florida, but it's really strong for the food. Mm-hmm. So and Harris,
New York might
Harris
be good
has
for
been
you.
Great for me. I'm sorry.
Harris.
Yeah, Harris has been great for me.
Yes.
New York, no brainer, cuz. But I've got so many friends, and I've been approached a million times. Mm-hmm. And I love every one of my friends. It would be hard for me to say, let's do something together. It would disrespect everybody else that's there.
Steve, what mistakes have you learned from?
Cannot please everybody. Most of the time, you really can't please yourself. That is a dark side of my life.
Marshall, no matter what you achieve.
Marshall will tell you he's never happy. Don't feel sorry for me because I'm never happy. That's not that kind of happiness. Like I said to you before, if you tell me it's the best you can do, don't work for me. You'll never get better. So she'll tell you, she'll say, what a great night. And I'll say, well, what about this? And what about that? It's no big deal. It's a big deal to me. We live in a world of everybody says what they want and writes what they want. So the new thing is now, if you disappoint or you have some kind of disagreement, I'm going to write a review. Well, years ago, food writers wrote a review. Good or bad, they wrote a review. Everybody feels they are food critics. And most of the time on our bad reviews is that it's very rarely about the food, very rarely about the service. It's mostly about what they cannot get or their music is too loud. There's a site, there's something about self-entitlement that when someone's paying for something, they should get what they want. And I respect that. If you go buy a Louis Vuitton bag for $5,000 and you want the red changed to blue, that's what I want. Louis Vuitton will not do it for you. Well, we're not talking about Louis Vuitton. We're talking about food. Well, if a dish is created and you make a change to it, it's not going to taste the way it's supposed to taste. And if you don't like what I've done the way you wanted it, you don't want to pay for it. So why would I do that? I'm not saying don't add cheese to a dish. We're flexible. But if you want to come in and say, can I have rigatoni and clams? No. I'm paying for it? No. So that review now goes to 1 star. Terrible experience. I wanted this. They wouldn't do it for me. But I'm there 28 years, so I must be doing something right. And these 2 locations were on 4 years. Yeah. And when you're in a casino and you lose $100,000, you want it your way. Well, I want to say, well, you lost $100,000 at a table. You're not going to lose here. It's going to be right here.
You talked about service just a moment ago. How important is it to offer the best service you can?
When I speak to people, they'll tell me the food. I went to a restaurant. Food was okay, but the service was great. We're going to go back. Could I deal with a bad waiter? Not filling my glass of wine up, glass of water up. Not getting me a new napkin, would it affect my experience? 100%. But if the food was great, I'd still go back. I would not go back because of service. I wouldn't. Could be a bad day, could be a new waiter, his mother could be sick, could be anything. But if I go back and my meal's bad twice, I give a place 2 times, then and it's hard when you run places when you're not there. It's amazing how people will say, the food's different when you're not here. When we first opened Vegas, I had to be gone for 6 months. There's, when the season in Florida, I could have 50 people waiting in line to get in. I get out of the car and a lady screams my name. I'm so glad you're here. My sister's here. Last time we're here, the eggplant stack was not good, Steve, not good. The guy that makes my eggplant stacks been with me for 24 years. I don't make the eggplant stack. I never did. I invented it. I incorporated it. I showed him how to do it. That night, the same guy that made it for it the first time made it for it again. Know what she said?
Delicious.
I told you when you're here, you make it better.
That's all the money.
So this is what you got to deal
with.
That's
right. Sure.
I think one of the most hardest parts being in this business that people, we live in a world that of internet, of being friends, and they're really not friends. You know nothing about them, but through what you see each other on Facebook. And it's kind of a, I don't know if to say it's a curse. Like people come and they want to talk to me when I'm like in a mix of cooking, and they want to, and I feel bad. Like
you're working.
I'm getting a divorce. My mother's sick. You just can't say that. I got, all right, now you got to listen. You know, you want to say, can you wait till I'm done? I'll sit at a table and talk the whole time. So people, and Marcia says it's kind of good because they feel they can talk to you at any time, but sometimes it's like difficult. And I don't say no to anybody. Anybody wants something from me, it's 99.9, I say yes to it, you know? So that's probably one of the hardest things that I have to deal with, that part. But the hardest part is being perfect. I know you can never be 100%. I know Frank Sinatra said, if you can please 50% of your people, you're ahead of the game. I'm always shooting for that 100. Will I ever get it? Probably not, but that's my personality. So do I enjoy my success? No, because I'm not successful. I'm still the guy cooking out of a basement. You know, I'm still that guy. We had about 30 meetings with big shots, college guys, and I say tomorrow, you got to lead this meeting, Ma. My words ain't going to come out right. So she leads it, and then when I don't see things going well and I start speaking my terms, which is a lot of bad words, and I express it, and I probably make myself look not appropriate, but I think that's my, that's it. So when you have to deal with hierarchy and people and business, you know you're not smart enough, you know you're not educated enough, you know you, like if we had a conversation, I need to think about it. I need to think about it and dwell on it before I can make a decision kind of thing, you know? And I shoot from the hip. So Marshall say, stop yelling. I said, the waiter's carrying walked past the table, he didn't pick up the dish. And you're a customer, that's how close I am. Is that the right way to do it? No, it ain't. It's all I know. Mm-hmm. But, so if you're in my house, your mother's yelling, I ain't gonna say nothing. If I come back to your mother's house, I'm okay with it. If they come back to me, they gotta be okay. Yeah. That's Steve. He cares about, you know, what he's doing, so.
Are you hard on your staff?
To a point, yeah, to a point. If something's on the floor and I pick it up, you better pick it up next time.
That's right.
I'm not gonna tell you to pick it up. I'm gonna pick it
You're
up.
You're not afraid to do tell it.
You. No, sir. No. I got a union here. I'll fight the union. I'll fight them. I'll leave. I'll lock the door and go home. If it's going to hurt my brand, affect my brand, I'll lock the doors and go back home. Mm-hmm. I started from a basement because I could eat scroll and beans every day. And I'm okay.
Social media. You have definitely used it to your advantage. I've been watching you.
I have no idea what I'm doing.
But you know what's great, Steve, is that you're just being you. Mm-hmm. And I could tell from the interactions of other people, they love that, and I love it. I love watching you. It's great. You know, where are you today? What are you doing? What are you talking about? How has it affected your life or your business?
I think that social media, like I told you, is there's good and there's evil, and it's all according to how people can say it could be very hurtful. They were very hurtful to Marcia. A lot of bad, negative things said to them. One guy, I talk about my friends. One guy had to go straighten out a guy, and he apologized, but they have that freedom, and it's sad that people can get hurt. You don't have to, I was bullied a little bit when I was younger, and until I stood up and gave my own beating to them. There's bullying on that, so people can get bullied on that, and they have no way of defending themselves except by deleting them. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean they don't feel that hurt first. Yeah. So it's all according with how you... if you can handle criticism, because I get criticized a lot on stuff, a lot. You got to be able to have thick skin, and you got to let things roll off you. And I'm not really that guy to let things, or you can always forgive but never forget. You know what I'm saying? Because, but it's a good tool to have to put. Do I think it increases business? Tell me something. I've got 50,000 followers between two things, right? If I post a dish, out of those 50,000, how many really live in Fort Lauderdale? You know what I'm saying? Right. Everybody could be everywhere that's liking. You got 7,000 likes, but maybe two of them are from Fort Lauderdale, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't know how that could help you bring business in, but it's a good tool. And what's scary, and I'll say this to all corporate likes you because it's free. It's free advertising. Sure. You have to pay no money.
Sure, sure. Any regrets?
You ever listen to the song Cycles by Frank Sinatra? If you haven't, listen to that. Just listen to the song Cycles. Beautiful song. Do I have regrets? Yes. I would have went to school. I would have studied. I would have found people that would mentor me, that I could learn from. I would have asked more questions instead of being so proud. I probably would have spent more time with my father. I didn't spend a lot of good quality time with him. You know, we are all products of our environment. People that are poor, they're born poor. It's just a cycle. But I believe that there's something inside you that everybody has. You just got to get it out to make a change. And I think my biggest regret is that I didn't do changes sooner. You know, sometimes you have to let go of your losses sometimes to start. Like I tell people, never give up. But if you're doing something and it's not really working and you're in debt and you can get thrown out of your house, yeah, but I'm still a painter. I'm still painting. Yeah, but then you're living on the street, but I'm still painting. There's a thin line there, you know? So I probably would have done a little bit more. I wouldn't have gotten debt in the beginning of my life. Like now, I got a mortgage payment. I own no credit cards. I own nobody. I own no banks, nothing, nobody. That's a good feeling to have. I just wish I had more people around me. I wish I had the computer, and I wish I had the internet service, and I could have learned so much more. The kids today, sure. The problem with kids today, there's no sense of urgency. There's no respect. They see so much, they don't grow up. There's no fun time for kids. They go from a baby to being an adult, at least thinking that they're an adult. There's no caring on what they do. And that's something I think is a downfall for the future of our kids. Mm-hmm. We grew up with a sense of urgency. We grew up with, you had to have a job, you had to pay bills. You never went to a place, how much do you pay? You went for a job, you do the work, they pay you. You're not, how much do you pay? That's it, I'm not working. Let me see what you can do first.
Today.
Yeah, it's sad. Yeah. It's sad.
How important, Steve, is it for people to find their passion to do what you're doing? I mean, it takes. I'm the same way. I'm now doing my passion, but it's, some of us it takes us longer than others. But for
some people,
for
never,
young
some people never find it.
Some people never find it.
I had a conversation with a guy that was in this business, and he just couldn't do it no more. Right. But he has had a passion for it. He doesn't know where it went. Well, it didn't go nowhere. It's still inside you. Everything is controlled by the mind. Heart has no feelings, no. It's a muscle, the heart. Everything's in your brain. Everything comes from here. So if you lost it, you got to try to find it. Go as deep as you need to get to get it back. But some people who have a passion don't really follow it. You know, like they'll do it like as a hobby, but they'll just do their job as something else. I don't think if I didn't have a passion for food, like everything's food for me, and music, I could not be where I'm at. I would have just kept doing something else. And a lot of people do something else. They don't do what they're supposed to be doing. You can follow your passion as a hobby till it clicks. Some people go, I can't do that and do both. Well, you don't want it that bad. What's that mean? You only slept 2 hours instead of six? Don't only sleep two if that's your passion.
Yeah.
If you're doing it for fun or for a hobby, it's a whole different ballgame.
Is there anything that you've adopted into your life that's kind of keeps you going? Do you do any practices? Do you I know you work out, right? Do you meditate or anything like that? I mean,
I try to pray 24 hours a day. You know, people go, how do you pray 24 hours a day? It's not words. There's not a prayer. Let me read the prayer. It's having a conversation with your creator. It's having a conversation with someone that you love. Having a conversation to a person that cares for you. So it could be as simple as, thank you for this interview today, dear Lord. I appreciate, you know, having him here and getting my story out. It's a prayer. You go on your way. You go to the elevator and there's a line. And you know you how long to get upstairs. But then another elevator opens up. You say, thank you, dear God, for having that elevator. It's always giving thanks. Even when the shit hits the fan, it's like, you know, this was a bad day for me, dear Lord. But you know what? I know it could have been worse. So thank you for the lesson that I learned from here. See, that's the prayer. Everybody thinks you got to sit down and say words over and over.
And it's that gratitude, right? The constant gratitude.
It's all gratitude. I told you, a giver will never be poor. He'll never be poor. When you give, it comes back 1,000 times more. But I can't give to you and then go tell the whole staff, you know what? That reporter had his son, and they were hungry, and so I gave him $100 to go to the buffet and get something to eat. What do you want, praise and glory?
Right.
You keep that to yourself. You keep that inside you. Nobody's, all you got to worry about him know about it. That's all.
When did this click for you?
Because I said to you, it's when been you good young? And evil all my life. It's just.
But
it's
when good. Did it click to say 24/7?
Probably more now, like now, at this time in my life. Some people, I'm 61. Some people, September 2nd, I'll be 61. Some people
Happy
say,
birthday.
Well, he's getting older, right? But everybody gets older, they fear death. You know what's amazing? Everybody believes in heaven, but nobody wants to go. Right? Nobody wants to go.
Right.
If I gotten sick and I couldn't get, if I wasn't cured from a miracle or medicine, I'm not dying with a sense of, oh my God, what am I, what? I was told that if I'm lucky enough, I'm able to go to heaven and see other people that I know in my life that made it to heaven.
Yeah.
So what's there to be? But if you're not sure, it can be scary, you know, but I don't have that.
How important is health and fitness to you?
I had a triple bypass.
No kidding.
Oh yeah, a triple bypass 10 years ago.
10 years.
And that's another long story, but with no problems, no heart problems, no heart attack.
Good.
Went in for see my doctor. I told him, you know, a little cardio, I had a little pain. He says, let's just go in, clean you out, send you home. He went in to clean me out, and I'm laying, and he looks at me, shaking his head. I'm like, oh, what are you shaking your head for? He says, Stevie, you got three clogged arteries, 98%. Man, I would go like this. Oh, my father, he went to bed, he went like this. Oh, my Aunt Philly went to lay down, went like this. So it's hereditary. It's hereditary. So
it was a blessing that you went
absolutely.
In.
Absolutely. So they cleaned me out, and I was still a street out partying guy. And he said, "We gave you another 50 years." And I said, "You don't want to give me another 50 years."
Yeah. Priceless.
But health is important. Yeah, very important.
Are you still working out several times every day?
Every day.
I see you and Marcia go together sometimes.
Every day. It's mental. If I don't go, like I could be miserable all day. It's. Unless you work out, you understand that's a mental thing that you got to do it. Even if it's something, but you got to do something.
Did you ever do anything crazy like these supplements or anything nuts?
No, not really. No. Like I there's a lot of guys I know that are, you know, they're using needles, they're juiced up, and there's no research on any of that stuff. You know, it's sad because a lot of times you see them guys; they all got their bellies.
Right.
That's how you can really.
What about
tell.
The other thing? It's like a HGH or something like
HGH.
That.
HGH. I take HGH.
You do.
I take HGH.
Can
and
you tell me about? Because I have not met anyone who's actually taken it, but I hear it has a lot of benefits.
My doctor's name is Dr. Fisher in South Florida. He's a health doctor, practitioner, MD. When we get older, we lose our HGH. And I have two doctors. I have that for my HGH, and I have my regular doctor, Dr. Warman, which is great. And you know, there's two sides to it, right? One says there's not enough research, they're not sure. I've done research, and I believe that we do lose it, and it helps keeps everything, your skin tighter as you get older. But I'm gonna make a statement that my doctor woman, who I love, Steve, why, you know, after the triple bypass, let's stay off your HGH. All right, doc, that's what you say, that's fine. I've never done a steroid, I'm supervised by my doctor, get my blood work every 3 months, and it's been about 10 years that I'm doing it. I feel great. I tell anybody to get on it. It's not what them bodybuilders are doing. I don't do that. After my test came back for my heart, after all the surgery, my HGH was so low that he called me on the phone and said, get back to Dr. Fisher. Get wow. back to him. Wow. And I went back and...
You know, does it help with muscle mass too?
Well, I'm 61, I feel good. Yeah. But is it? I'm not bulky like bodybuilders. So I don't want that. Right. You know, I just want to be healthy.
Yeah.
And I think that's the future. I really do. I think all men over 50 should look into
consider
that.
It. Yeah. We talked about your faith. It's very important to you.
Absolutely. It's everything.
It's everything to you. Now, if you could take your cell phone out right now and call the 20-year-old Steve,
what would I tell him?
What would you tell him?
I'd probably curse him up and down. But a telephone call wouldn't work. I'd probably set up a meeting so I could see him and really give him a smack here and there to say what you thought was right wasn't right. What you thought was going to be your future was not your future. When God called me the first time and I listened to him, my life might not be this way, but I think I would have done something even bigger if I would have listened. This is like, I came later. He won't keep you unless you accept. He's not going to keep you. He's not going to let you go. He's going to wait till you come. And I came at a late time. But I was always that guy that I would have said to him, instead of going out with your friends, go to school, right? Learn. Instead of getting high, go home and read. Instead of worrying about your friends laughing at you, study. You know, study and just find out. Information is key to everything. Learn. We laughed at guys like that. You understand? We laughed at guys that were going to college. We laughed at geeks. Geeks are like the biggest thing today. You're a geek. You want to be a geek. We laughed at those guys. But in the end, they were the smart ones, not us. All my close friends are dead. All dead. You know, so it's like, I know there's a short period here, but guess what? As long as I wake up in the morning and I put my feet on the ground, I'm going to touch somebody's life that day. And I